It's amazing to think how a little bit of smart thinking in terms of retrofit and refurb can take our buildings forward in new and better directions. And Energy House One is certainly the proof of that. But it's also just the beginning, because Energy House Two forms a whole new phase for the University of Salford's great project. Energy House Two, counter to the first facility, is all about new build. It's about what's possible and feasible when you include innovation and sustainability right from the foundations. So let's take a closer look with a tour of this cutting-edge facility and hear from some of the people involved in putting its principles into real-world practice. So Richard, tell me about Energy House 2.
Mm-hmm. So where we stood here is one of our two chambers. So we have two chambers, they're both identical. They're both big enough, as you can see, to fit two full-size houses in, real houses. And the special thing about these chambers is that they allow us to amend the weather. Okay, so we can go down to minus 20 and we can go up to plus 40 with wind, rain, snow, solar radiation. And that allows us basically to recreate about 95% of the globally populated land mass. So anywhere where people live, we can recreate that conditions, which is really interesting, because you can take a building like this one behind us and we can say, does it work now under winter and summer conditions, for instance? But then we can fast forward through the climate change predictions and we can go 30, 50 or 80 years in the future and we say, what does it do then? Does it start to overheat? What's the running cost? Does it have a cooling load then on the building and things like that? So, that can only be done here. It's called Believe Unique.
Because a lot of this stuff is done in computers, isn't it? So there's a lot of modelling that goes on in computers, but actually there's a disconnect sometimes between the modelling in a computer and what actually happens when you build it.
So a very well qualified academic, certainly better than me, always says that all models are bad, but some of them can be used in a good way. And we're all about generating measured data. So we build a house, literally the house here, and then we test it to within an inch of its life. And then we have a lot of data at the end of that to say what the performance was. Now that can then be used for modeling. And then we can say, we can put it into climate change models, we can put it into energy performance models, running cost models, SAP and RDSAP, and all the other models that we use. But what we generate what's called a calibrated model. So we've got calibrated models of these buildings that are accurate to within better than less than 5%. So it's really, really tight for a model. So that allows us then to do some super cool stuff in terms of putting these together on estates and things like that and in a virtual world. So, but we can only do that because we've got these accurate measured data.
So this is like the calibration, you know, you can calibrate everything that you need in the wider world.
Yeah.
There's huge amounts of insight from here.
Absolutely. We can, you know, designers like to design things to very close tolerances. Oftentimes when they get built slightly different because of, they might be built on a Friday afternoon, they might have a product substitution, they might not be commissioned very well. So what we can do is find out how these buildings actually work. So it's really valuable.
Is that not a bit of a moment of realization for manufacturers and designers? Because there's this thing called the performance gap, isn't there? That what we think a building is going to do, and actually when it's built, and often there's a big gap, isn't there? There's a big difference in energy consumption.
So studies out of Leeds Beckett done recently have found performance gaps of up to 150%. You know, so design against actual performance, which is horrifying, really. So the performance gap, for instance, that we found on these two buildings here, have both been less than 10%, so about 4%, 7%. So actually really well-performing buildings. But we only know that because we can measure them under really controlled conditions. If we were to go out in the field and do this, well, A, the heating studies, for instance, that we've just carried out probably would have took us at least 5 years to do. And the uncertainty associated with A, people, B, the weather outside, C, you know, the different conditions inside the buildings, would have just led us to have far bigger uncertainty than we have here. So basically we do everything like a physics experiment. We change one thing, we measure it, It's simple physics, basically.
And what insights are coming out of this experiment and being fed into the industry?
So we've done two significant reports, and they're both public. They're both on our website, and we've done them for both homes that we see here. So the first one was looking at fabric. So the fabric performance report took the design and compared it with all the things that we measured. So the things we measured were airtightness, U values across many, many points of the wall, floor, ceiling, windows, and roof. And then finally, we looked at the airtightness of the building and did a very deep thermography study. So we did find some problems, and we found problems across both of the homes in the loft. So poorly laid loft insulation. So that's generally when it gets laid and then it gets disturbed and then, you know, lifted up by different people and then probably not put down quite right. Easy to fix, but it led to a minor but important performance gap in both of the buildings. And then we had some issues with the timber frame panels, and we found some workmanship issues there, and we've addressed those in a separate test building and we fixed that. And we found some slight underperformance in air tightness, but again, it's difficult to make these buildings airtight when they've got, so the one over here, for instance, the Bellway House, has got 7 heating systems in it.
What's potential?
and probably about 2 kilometers of network cable that I asked them to put in.
Right.
So many, many more holes than you would find on a typical house. So there is reasons for that. But all that gear, if you like, allows us to take very important measurements. So the second and really interesting report that we put out was looking at the different ways of heating these buildings. So both house builders took a view that they were going to test multiple systems. And the multiple systems that are floating around at the moment generally are things like electric heating, direct heating, infrared heating, air source heat pump, and then the different ways of getting that heat into the building. So underfloor heating, radiators, and the house behind us here has skirting board heaters, for instance, the perimeter heating. It was about efficiency, a lot of this, how much energy it took to get the building to a set point. So we tended to compare it with the SAP model. So the SAP model says 21 in the living room, 18 everywhere else. And we did it at 2 different temperatures. We did it 5 degrees in the chamber here, and -5 degrees in the chamber. So 5 degrees is your average winter temperature. -5 is probably on the more extreme side of the winter, but it does happen. The interesting finding here was the different ways that the systems were operating. So we set our controls up in 2 ways. We did the standard, let's call it a SAP pattern, which the government energy model says is 7 till 9 in the morning, then it goes off, then 4 till 11 at night. And that's often the way that people use.
Yes, that's a pretty standard way.
Gas boilers, we tend to use it a lot like this. And then the second way we tested was continuous. So all the way through the day, 24 hours, 21 in the living room and 18 everywhere else. And at 5 degrees, both of those things worked, and not a significant problem. However, when we bring the temperature down to -5, that really kind of stresses some of our design calculations. And it really stresses them when we're looking at this 7 till 9 and 4 till 11.
Because the building's just cooling down and heating up.
Absolutely, it's cooling down and heating so quick. So even these really well insulated and really good standard air tightness homes, we were getting absolutely nowhere near the set point in the morning. So we were finding, you know, 12 degrees in the morning and probably not much higher, 13 or 14 degrees in the evening pattern, if you like, because that's not the way that heat pumps are meant to work. They're meant to work on a low and slow. That's how they work. Having said that, if someone moves into these houses from a gas boiler situation, that's probably not the way they would set it. So we think there's quite a bit of work to be done around systems and design and handover as well, and making sure that when people move into these, I mean, let's not get this wrong, these are efficient homes.
Yeah.
And they're efficient systems. They're doing exactly what they're designed to do. But if you use them in a different way, maybe a way that the manufacturers don't expect you to use them, then they're not going to cut it. If you go back home to your gas boiler and you're banging heat into that building at 74 degrees, it will heat up really quickly, even at -5, and it'll do that work. But when our air source heat pump here is dishing out heat between 35 and 45 degrees, even in a well-insulated home, at minus five,
it isn't
they
working.
Struggle to do that.
And I suppose this is what this facility gives you, is the ability to get right into the data, understand how that physics is working, and then you can broadcast that message out to the industry.
And testing's to the extreme as well. To wait for a minus five day outside in the real world might take a year or two in Manchester. And to wait for 3 days at minus five, which is what we tested it at, you wait forever.
Yeah.
That was like the beast from the east was the last time we had that. But what we can do here, just we pop upstairs, we press a button, and it comes down to minus five in a day. So the beauty of that is now we can redesign these systems, improve them, add more heat emitters, maybe turn up the flow slightly, and then we retest it again at five and minus five, and we see what happens. So we've got the answer. We know if it's fixed before these folks go out and build 50,000 of them every year.
And that's really the purpose, to refine system approaches.
Absolutely,
and get these, because when you get into super high efficiencies, it really is about those margins, isn't it?
Absolutely.
It makes all the difference.
And when you're working with air source heat pumps, the same as gas boilers to a certain extent, commissioning's really important. And they won't reach the efficiency that we require and that the manufacturers state as well if they're not commissioned correctly. And also, you've got this idea of if the occupant isn't getting warm enough, they will turn up that flow temperature, which will reduce the performance of the heat pump. It's counterintuitive to a lot of people, but, you know, and then we're going to see people having issues with bills and things.
So that's the thing of bringing it out of the computer and into reality. And
absolutely.
This is a controlled reality, and then taking that on into the industry and into the market.
Absolutely.
And are you getting a lot of manufacturers coming in and asking to use the facility and to collaborate with you guys?
It's an endless stream of inquiries, which we're grateful for. What we have to do is is stacking them all up in a big queue and take them one at a time, basically. But there's only one of these buildings in the world. We have Energy House, which you've seen, that looks deeply at retrofit, and that's as busy, you know, probably busier than we are at the moment. But there's a lot of new products coming on stream, and they all have to have a degree of testing. And they can do that on the bench, you know, we can bench test things. But we like to think that when the bench testing has proved something works, then it's time to put it into a whole house system, which is this. We don't replace field trials, and we would never dream of doing that. We do field trials as well, but we see it as a stage. You develop a product, you put it on the bench, you put it in something like this, and then you move it out into the field. And then you've covered all your, you know, possible risks, really.
And so do you think that the role that this facility is going to have in the move towards zero carbon is pretty significant? I mean, certainly sounds it.
I think so. I think what we'd like to say is that we've proven things work and don't work. We've given the data to say why that happened. We've also made some suggestions of how it could be improved, but you would never let an academic design a building.
Okay?
We wouldn't want to take your job, for instance, because that's not what we do. We would never design heating systems. We would never design buildings because that's an industry thing. We can give some advice, but what we say is there's the problems, that's how we think we can fix it, and we'll test it again. And hopefully that helps our zero carbon ambitions.
And speeds up the pace of development.
Absolutely, absolutely.
Energy House 2 is just the latest development in the University of Salford's ongoing efforts to roll back the frontiers of construction. But what does the future have in store for the innovations pioneered here? Join us next time as we chart the pathway from theory to practice on the next episode of Building Better.